A reef is not just a place. Not just a collection of corals. Not just a scientific phenomenon. It is a subjective experience. Something that comes out of an engagement between the human and the place. Something that's part of the mind and the heart as much as it is the physical object.
As a historian, I find it so strange that while we know a lot about the natural history of this beautiful place, the seas, the cay, the reefs itself, we still know so very little about the human history of the reef. In this series, I'm going to be traveling the length and breadth of the Great Barrier Reef to explore how humans, past and present, have shaped this marvelous Australian icon. And how we, as a nation, have been shaped by it.
Well, Cook lucked out, didn't he?
If he had landed on that other side,
yeah,
the story may have been different.
You bet it was.
It's a history found in some of the remotest places on Earth.
He would have died on that strip of rock with the rest of the Chinese labourers.
And it's one that never fails to surprise and shock.
This 14-year-old boy has been abandoned, and he's in a place like he's never seen before. It is utterly vast.
What we've been imagining is a myth. The man who created that myth for the Great Barrier Reef was Ted Banfield.
They see among the crowd of Aborigines on the shore a wild-looking, copper-coloured man. At once, they recognise him as a white man.
And it's a history we almost never had. We nearly lost it to someone who wanted to mine it for oil and gas. And it was only three concerned citizens who mobilised to save it at that point. They are ill-qualified to fight this. They said, in effect, bugger that.
These were the men and women, the Australians and the foreigners, the saints and the sinners, who've shaped our ideas and our feelings about the greatest marine environment this planet has ever known.
It's my great pleasure to be involved in this session. I'll just, in case some of you don't know about Iain McCalman, he's an extremely distinguished Australian academic, I'll read of his career. He was born in Nyasaland in 1947, schooled in Zimbabwe, did his higher education in Australia. His second last book, Darwin's Armada, won three prizes. It was the basis of the TV series Darwin's Brave New World. He's a fellow of three learned academies and a former president of the Australian Academy of the Humanities. He's director of the Humanities Research Centre, ANU, and from 1995 to 2002, from 1995 to 2002, and won the inaugural Vice Chancellor's Prize at ANU for teaching excellence, which I think you can see the teaching impulse in the short promotion for the reef that we've just seen. Former Federation Fellow and currently Research Professor in History at the University of Sydney, co-director of the Sydney Environment Institute, and an Officer of the Order of Australia, a very distinguished career. I want, just before I start, Iain, maybe you could say a little bit about the films that you've made as part of this teaching impulse that you have, because they may be of interest to people in the audience.
Oh, thanks, Robert. Yeah, I sort of hold the view that we've entered a kind of visual age, an age of visual culture, and that especially younger people often don't get their ideas from books as much as they do from films or, you know, websites and so on. So I've been trying to match, when writing a book, trying to match those kinds of products. And so Darwin's Armada, we did three museum exhibitions of it, and we did a website for the ABC, and then we also did that TV series. And for the Reef, there is at the moment somebody trying to get up an international film series, but I've made a website which is especially pitched at students and school students and university students, but at anybody. It's just lowercase thereef.com.au. And it contains three films that I made that are part of the book. A lot of interviews from Indigenous people, such as the one you just saw a glimpse of, and a lot of information about the Reef that I think could be useful for people when they're doing projects and that kind of thing. I'm proud to say it won an Oscar of websites, which is called a Webby. It won a Webby out of 12,000 international entries. So anyway, I'd be delighted if you send kids or yourselves or anyone else to it. Those people who don't feel they can wade their way through my book. Thanks very much, Robert.
So I'm going to try and introduce as much as I can this book by the questions I ask. I just want to say something about my own reaction to the book first. And it begins with an admission. I agreed to conduct this conversation that was invited by Rosemary Sorensen to do so before I'd read The Reef. And as it happens, my gamble paid off. The book I'm about to discuss with its author, Iain McCalman, is truly wonderful. And I wouldn't say that if I didn't mean it. On the surface, it's a straightforward book, 12 vivid stories told in chronological order of European encounters with the environs and indigenous peoples of the Great Barrier Reef, beginning with the great explorer Captain Cook, concluding with the great marine biologist Charlie Verrin. But just beneath the surface, in my reading, it is in reality a very complex book. Using these stories to show the changing ways in which the Reef has entered and impacted upon the Australian and world public, whose end result, I think, is a portrait of the many dimensions of the Reef that now exist in what I would call our collective imagination. Each new story builds upon the last, adding a dimension to the earlier portrait, modifying but not negating what has come before. And I'm going to take a liberty, I don't know what Iain will think about this, but the Reef is constructed, in my view, a little like a coral reef, layer upon layer. Iain traces our imaginative picture of the Great Barrier Reef through three phases. He calls terror, nurture, wonder. Although, in fact, I think he also records a more recent fourth, which I would call deepening apprehension about its future. So, if I can begin at the beginning, Iain, tell us how you fell in love with the Great Barrier Reef.
It's kind of a horror story, actually. I was persuaded by the BBC and Discovery Channel to go on what I thought was a kind of filmic exploration of the reef, and I was to be an expert to talk about the history. As it turned out, it was really a kind of Big Brother at Sea, one of these reality TVs, things where the whole purpose of it was to give us an appalling time and frighten us and cause us to leave the ship and, you know, all these kinds of things. But it was conducted in the replica of the Endeavour under 18th century conditions as far as was possible at that time, and we were able seamen. Climbing, climbing a 174-foot up without a safety harness, and on and on. But the fact of the matter is, we sailed in Cook's wake, if you like, in a wooden ship, which doesn't disturb the sea nearly as much as a diesel screw, and it was absolutely ravishing experience. I have, other than my own Lake Nyasa in Malawi, I've never come across a place of such extraordinary beauty and complexity. It's not really just a reef, it's a country. I don't know how many of you realize that the reef taken in its area is bigger than England and Ireland put together. It's bigger than Japan. It is one of the most extraordinary phenomena on Earth. It's the only thing living thing that astronauts can see when they look out on the little blue oval that is our planet. So I fell in love with it, and it was also whilst I was on, there were indigenous people on board, and I got to hear their stories about what the reef had meant to them and how their losses of their own country had altered their lives in the most unendurable way, really. And the final thing was that I encountered on Lizard Island a young biologist who introduced me for the first time to seeing coral that had been bleached, just skeletons like those white crosses in on the Somme, these white skeletons. And I had really not taken seriously the idea that this massive place could be possibly vulnerable. So, and I remember feeling, I mean, I was actually quite weepy after I heard that story, and I took a little swim in the water at Lizard Island, and it was so unbelievably beautiful, and I kind of vowed at that point to do something about it. It took me about 10 years to get round to it. So that's how it happened. Yeah.
And I want to ask you now about the writing of the book. A very admired scholarly historian, former head of the Academy of the Humanities. And anyone reading this book will recommend, particularly historians, which I once sort of was, still am in a way, would recognise how much scholarly work there has gone into it. On the other hand, it's obviously written in order to give pleasure to general readers,
yes,
as most scholarly books don't. And I'm asking that in a way as an insider to the trade. How difficult did you find that combination of scholarship and readability, writerliness?
It is really difficult. I think I've still got an L plate there, you know. But it was about 10 or 12 years ago I had a kind of epiphany and decided I was not going to continue my career writing for my own peers, that it was just completely pointless. I mean, they shared my views anyway, that really what I should try to do is to reach out to a general public.
Yes.
And I mean, I really hadn't done it before that. And, you know, you get so used to using the language of your own peers and, you know, you don't realise how, in fact, limited your communication powers are. So I'm still learning. But the last three books have been trade books, as they call them, written for a general public. And it's hard. I think it's hard, especially when you're dealing with really complex science, and I'm not even a scientist, to try and convey those things in a way that doesn't bore people or put them off and just, you know, the tedium of that kind of thing. So, yeah, it's a challenge.
And I promise the audience here and those who haven't read the book, it's extraordinarily readable. I had the pleasure, I was in this, read it in the South Island of New Zealand, which is one of the most beautiful places on Earth.
Yeah, absolutely.
Not overrun by tourists even. And it was a perfect place to read it, and the book gave me incredible pleasure. There's another question that occurred to me. Again, it's a slightly insider's question. You've condensed your book about the reef to 12 stories.
Yes.
More characters, but 12
yes.
stories, many of which involve three or four main protagonists. How difficult was the sifting process? It looks as if it's all natural, but in fact you must have had to make very difficult decisions about who, what to include, what to exclude. Could you say a little bit about that?
Yes, I mean, that's absolutely true. I had to... there's a lot of people on the cutting room floor, you know, that just in the end I wanted to... You're right, you know, I wanted to tell a story that, although it's made up of individual sections, is a story that I feel connects. And I use these three categories. Robert is right. There is a fourth one, a shadow of a fourth one over it. But the three categories were, in the beginning, the reef was about terror. I mean, Captain Cook hated it beyond description. And almost everybody for half a century or more thought of the reef as hellish. Cook called it an insane labyrinth, full of savages, full of coral, full of deadly creatures and so on. And then I wanted to look at the people for whom the reef was a nurture. It had always been something that nurtured them and they it, and that was the indigenous people. It's hard to get at their stories because they didn't write them down, except through some extraordinary and I think little known stories about castaways. Women, a woman and a man who lived with him for very long periods of time and in effect became indigenous. And so that's how I picked these people. I did leave one person out because I could not write her story without utter revulsion.
Can you say?
Yes, I'm not going to say who it was, but it was a German naturalist, an early German naturalist, who I thought was a very bold and brave person to be doing these things at this time. But I discovered that she had paid somebody to shoot an Aboriginal person and skin them and send them back to Germany. And I couldn't write that story. That story is for someone else to write.
Well, let's begin to... to go through the book and get you to talk, not too long, or we won't. About the some of the characters that emerge and their relationship to the reef. The book begins with two great explorers, the greatest probably James Cook, but also Matthew Flinders.
Yes.
But their relationship to the reef is very different, I think, and in a way. The man who begins it seems to think of it not merely as a terror, Matthew Flinders.
Yes.
Could you say a little bit about the contrast between how these two explorers kind of reacted to and felt about the reef?
Well, I suppose the thing we have to imagine ourselves is, imagine Cook's predicament, is that he didn't know the reef existed. And Flinders did. And Cook actually sailed for 800 kilometres within the reef without realising it existed, because it was out of sight. Yeah, it's like a big fish trap. The reef on the southern entrance, it's more than 200 kilometres wide, so you can sail. You know, you bump into islands and things. But it contracts, and it didn't really discover it until he hit it. And then they managed to save the boat, but for him it was a desperate case of survival. And then getting out of the reef, when this boat can barely—I've sailed it. You can't manoeuvre it. You know, it can only sail about 90 degrees into the wind. So, and it's extremely cumbersome. And the reef is a minefield. How Cook sailed through it without any charts is just a miracle of sailing. But Flinders was different. He was a young man, really ambitious. I think both a passionately literary person as well as a scientist, whereas Cook was very self-taught guy, and he wanted to beat Cook in a sense. He wanted to do a better job than Cook of doing this, and also going much more systematically through the reef. So in a sense, he has an advantage. And in doing this, and he also has the advantage of Cook's charts, you know. But his charts are magnificent. And it is true that Cook never really realised how big the reef was. You know, really only thought of the reef as from Cooktown onwards when he'd bumped into it. Whereas Flinders is the first person to encompass the whole idea and to coin the word barrier reef.
And then Great Barrier Reef.
Yeah, and then Great Barrier Reef, yeah. So that was their difference, really.
And I want now to look at another contrast of two women who were shipwrecked, Eliza Fraser and Barbara Thompson. Now, I know a little bit about Eliza Fraser. I, to be honest, had never heard of Barbara Thompson.
Yes.
And my reading is... and if you could comment on this. One, Eliza Fraser has an enormous impact on collective myth.
Yes.
To do with Australia and to do with the reef and to do with Indigenous people. Barbara Thompson's story to me was much more interesting, and yet it somehow failed to capture imagination. Could you tell us why Eliza Fraser plays such a role in our mythology? And the story of Barbara Thompson, and why it didn't sort of enter popular mythology.
Well, it's a sad comparison, really, because Eliza Fraser spent 5 weeks with Indigenous people, and she had a rough time, not because they treated her badly, but because they lived in very rough circumstances, and she had to share that. But in the end, what happened was that she was a sensation, and she found her story became more and more embellished. And it was a story about the brutality of the Indigenous people, the fact that they murdered her, they tortured her, the implication was that it sexually violated her. That story was then taken to Britain, where, in effect, a kind of hack
it's
journalist.
It's an incredible story.
This hack journalist then turned it into a real rip snorter. And that's the one that has lived on. And we've taken that one up because it's salacious in a way, because of the sex element, but also because it's a story of the brutality of the Indigenous people. Barbara Thompson, or as she was known by the people of the Torres Strait who looked after her, Jom, lived... She was young. She was only 13 when she was shipwrecked.
Tell the audience roughly the years of Barbara Thompson.
Yeah, so Barbara Thompson's not that long after. She's really in the 1830s, 1820s, 1830s. She's shipwrecked. She spends 5 years with the people in the Torres Strait. And again, nearly loses her language, becomes, you know, lives as a Torres Strait Islander, is treated very well, and never, ever denies that. She's treated extremely well. She was treated like a pet, in a way, and spared from extra hard work, given an island to herself and so on. And so when the story of her rescue, she was rescued and taken back to Sydney, it just sunk without a trace. I mean, no one wanted to know a good news story.
And she was questioned in detail by a very talented ethnographer.
Yes, that's the extraordinary thing about her. It was a very, very talented and sympathetic person who was on board the boat. He was the ship's artist. And he asked her in detail about the life. So there are 30 manuscript volumes about, with the most incredible drawings as well. And that just disappeared. And so what stood in its, what has stood is the 5 week sojourn of that has been made into films and been made into operas, and it's been huge painting series. Jom, no one knows about her, but there is plenty to tell.
And just something I hadn't planned to ask, but I'm now curious. And what's happened to these 30 volumes of?
Well, they're still there in the Mitchell Library.
Have scholars worked much?
Well, 10 years ago, maybe a bit more than that, probably more like 20 years ago, a talented anthropologist took extracts from them and wrote this book. But here again, you know, it was an academic book. I mean, it's like most of our academic books, what, 200 yes. readers, maybe, if you're lucky? And so it was never read. I mean, it's a terrific book.
So you've actually introduced the story to the
In the popular sense, yes. I also did go to the manuscripts because they're much richer than the extracts. But the book of extracts is very, very good and very carefully annotated. Uh-huh. It's a great piece of
scholarship. Some of you might be interested in following it up, including me. Another contrast, if I could, there's one chapter which is about two men who lived amongst the indigenous people, an Englishman, James Morrill, and a Frenchman, Narcisse Pelletier.
Pelletier, yeah.
Rather than tell the whole story, the bit that I'd like you to talk about, which fascinated me, was how difficult both of them in quite different ways found it when they returned to what is called civilization after their experiences, and the kind of alienation in a way both seemed to have in the world that they now inhabited, having lived in one world and come back to another. Can you say a little bit about both?
Yes, I just say very quickly, I mean they had both spent, actually curiously, both spent 17 years with indigenous people. Morrill was slightly older, so it had probably had less impact on him. He was already in his 20s, whereas Narcisse Pelletier was 14. So, you know, it was much more transformative. And Morrill did go back voluntarily. Morrill was experiencing, he was in the middle of really the great wave of pastoralism. In the area, it's really an area of the Barrier Reef. I'm just trying to think how to describe exactly where it is. It's in the southern end of the reef, and it's now very much cane country. But he went back voluntarily, and he was more or less welcomed, and spent went back and lived for I think about 2 years. 2.5 years as a white man who was returned. But it was a terrible experience for him. He was treated by the whites as an emissary or a secret spy of the Aborigines, and by the Aborigines as someone who had let them down. I mean, he came and said, "I will stop these people from shooting you and taking away your land," or at least I will try. So he had a very sad, and I think as a result, died after only 2.5 years. But Pelletier's story is much, much sadder. I mean, Pelletier was a really assimilated indigenous person, very, very much admired in his tribe, and almost certainly married with children. And he was seen in 1875 by a bêche de mer, group of white people collecting bêche de mer, and captured. They called him, they rescued him at gunpoint, and then he was actually manacled. I mean, he tried to escape 4 times. And event, you know, after a long period of time, he was taken back to France where his family were. But his family found him repulsive. I mean, he had scarifications on his chest. He had elongated ear with the earlobe. He was, to them, a savage. They had him, the first thing they did was to have him taken into a Catholic church and have him, exorcised. So he was miserable. And they made him a lighthouse keeper, and he just stared out to sea, you know, thinking about the sand beach where he'd come from, his home, his people. In effect, he kind of died of a broken heart. He had almost no friends. So I think it's a really sad story. It's almost like the first stolen child in an odd kind of way.
Also, as you're talking, it's if there's a filmmaker in Australia, it would be a wonderful film.
Oh,
to
I think it would.
A Werner Herzog kind of film.
Yeah,
it's a haunting story.
It's a haunting story, and it's been very little known because he spoke to a medical man when he first went back. He was taken into hospital to see if how he was, and he told his story, and his story is very, very interesting about the indigenous life, the maritime life of a young man. But it was in French, and so it wasn't translated into English until 2009. So it hasn't spread into Australia, really.
I'd love to go on further, but we must move on.
Yeah.
Then I want you to talk about the two 19th century scientists you deal with, Jukes and William Kent. I must say again, Jukes is a very attractive figure. The William Kent story is fascinating. Perhaps a little bit about their scientific contribution, because both seems very important, but also I can't resist asking you to tell a little bit about the prehistory of William Kent, which, again, I had never heard this story, and it was fascinating.
So, yeah, William Kent, Jukes, and unfortunately I've got a student now at last, I'm writing a PhD on Jukes, because he was the first person who was a very sympathetic geologist who came out here with a British survey ship.
Quite early.
Yes, in the 1840s. He actually really, really liked Indigenous people and tried to learn language and had very good relationships with them and with other people in the Torres Strait. And in effect, he has three sources of fame. He was the first scientist to really understand what the Great Barrier Reef was and to have some sense of how it came into being. So his science is extraordinary. But he was the first person that I know of to really love the environment. He fell in love with the beauty of the reef and wrote about it in the most moving way. And thirdly, who had this very strong sympathy for the Indigenous people as a sort of ethnographer. He too is completely forgotten. And part of what I want my student to do is to explain to me why this man was so forgotten. He was a contemporary of Darwin and Huxley and all those people, friends of theirs, who also, Huxley also came out here. So what happened to this man?
And he wrote a good book.
Oh, yes, very good book, very good book. Very positive book about the... It's the only one of the survey voyages that has never been published because it's all about how good the Indigenous people were.
The theme is beginning to emerge in a way.
honestly, you can't... I had no sense of this when I began the book, but, at the end of it, I just... William Kent is a bizarre story.
Late 19th century.
Yeah, late 19th century. He had a very, very difficult, unpleasant father, who in effect persecuted his mother and also gave her syphilis, which was passed down to William Kent in a way congenitally. And his younger sister. He had an older sister. And the two kids first tried to run away. They had a stepmother brought who was the governess, who was being openly, openly kind of dealt with while the mother was there. They tried to run away when they were 11 and 12. It's a story that gets into Dickens's last novel. And they were brought back. And they were, today we would say they were children who had been tormented, psychologically and utterly tormented. Anyway, in 1860, when he was just about 14 and his sister were 15, one night they secretly went out and took away their 3.5-year-old half-brother and cut his throat. And there were never... the sister who adored her brother confessed and took the whole rap and kept quiet so that he could have a scientific career. Anyway, to cut a long story short, and the relevance to the reef is that he was a very tormented man. I mean, he was never caught. His sister spent 22 years in prison. And when she did come out, they all came out to Australia. I think that they had a reconciliation, and the sister became a nurse here. Was eventually, would you? I just have to tell you this: at when she was 100, received a letter of congratulation from the Queen. At the same time, she was in the Madame Tussauds waxworks as the worst murderess. Anyway, the thing about him is that he fell in love with the reef. The reef was his redemption in a way, and he produced the most magnificent book because it's not only... he was a photographer, so he's the first photographer of the reef, first really the intense science of the reef, and he did paintings of these glorious fish, coloured fish, and the sea creatures that are all there in plates at the back. They're chromolithographs. So that's why he enters into the story. But he is a man, I think he was redeemed,
yeah,
as it were.
It's a redemption story.
Yeah, yeah.
And he also, as a minor footnote, as we academics say, he seems to have created the idea of culture pearls.
Yes, he did.
Worked out how you could do it.
Yeah, yeah, he worked out how he did. I think his formula was eventually stolen, actually. It went into the Japanese, but he had worked it out, and there is detail to show that. Yeah.
Now the my ignorance, I didn't know this, but the great scientist of coral reef formation is unexpectedly Charles Darwin.
Yes.
I'd like you to say something about where his theories now stand, but before that, you tell again a fascinating story of the son of the Harvard professor of zoology. The son is Alex
Agassiz.
I didn't know how to pronounce it. Anyhow, the son is Alex. The father, Louis,
yes,
was a creationist at the time of Darwin and much maligned, particularly by the German Haeckel.
Yes.
And his son, Alex, in a way, seems to spend his life on this quixotic mission to prove Darwin wrong in order to, as it were,
vindicate his father's name
of the mockery that Haeckel, not Darwin, had visited upon him.
Yes.
There are two parts of the question. Firstly, the story of Agassiz, and secondly, where Darwin's theory now stands understand it in the science.
So Darwin's theory of coral reefs was his first contribution as a scientist. He wrote it long before he wrote The Origin of Species. In fact, he wrote it on board ship when he was out here in the Southern Hemisphere in 1835, when he was travelling to New Zealand from Australia. He drafted it, and it was his most deductive. I mean, it was a brilliant deduction. You can't believe it. But normally he was very, very careful about his research, but he got this idea. Anyway, the idea did prevail for quite a long time. And what happened really was that Agassiz decided he was going to go round to all the coral reefs of the world. He was a millionaire, made a lot of money in mining. And he went round the world in this mission to try and prove Darwin wrong. And it revived the whole controversy of evolution again, so that, you know, the fights that went on at the time of the origin of species were being refought over the Barrier Reef. So it's another area where the reef comes into global comprehension by the scientists.
What was the issue, in fact? The anti-Darwin, what were they trying to say?
They were trying to say Darwin's theory is simply this. Because the little creatures that create the limestone that makes reefs have to have light. They've got little plants in them that achieve photosynthesis. And if they don't have light, they can't create the oxygen that gives them the energy to build against the great forces of the sea. So Darwin says, how on earth can they have done it? I mean, these reefs are going down to the depths of the ocean. How on earth could they have done it? There's no light there. And he realizes that there must have been subsidence, very slow subsidence of the ocean floor, so that these little creatures were always seeing light as they went down. And then they died, of course, but there were always some on top of them. So that the whole of the Barrier Reef down below is as a dead piece of rock, in effect, limestone, with a living crust always. And it's an absolutely ingenious idea. And they refuted it. They were saying, no, it had to be volcanoes that were coming up, or the falling of animals. You know, hundreds of limestone animals were building little sort of mountains underneath. So that's what the controversy was. It's very, very hard to prove. It wasn't proven because you have to drill right down to find out if this really was coral all the way down. If it was coral all the way down, Darwin's right. If it's not coral, then he's wrong. And it wasn't until they were doing the Americans were doing atomic explosions and things in the South Pacific, and then drilling down to see the results, that they actually proved that Darwin was right. Yeah.
But still, the work that in this quixotic campaign to vindicate his father, that work still mattered.
It did, yeah. It actually produced an ecology, the first really ecological study of a coral reef and a coral island. It came out of this, and that was in Murray Island in the Torres Strait in 1913. Yeah.
So we're moving now, coral building
to the present,
to the 20th century, and from science in a way to the imaginative vision of the Great Barrier Reef. And one aspect of that is the Paradise Island, the tropical island.
Yes, yes.
And you tell, again, wonderful story of Ted Banfield, Dunk Island, Confessions of a Beachcomber. Could you tell us a bit about what you think Banfield added to this collective mythology of the Great Barrier Reef?
Yeah, that's right. I mean, Banfield is the first person to tell us that the Great Barrier Reef and the environments of coral reefs was a paradise, not a piece of hellish
terror.
He really is the first person, and that's when he publishes the Confessions of a Beachcomber, 1908. So it's pretty late, but that book was read all around the world, and Banfield's books were read all around the world. He was a journalist in Townsville, who had a bit of a mental and physical breakdown, and the doctor gave him 3 months to live, and he decided, you know, damn it, I'm going to go and live get out of the rat race. And so they went to Dunk Island with one indigenous person who really very important in introducing them to, and in fact in allowing it to live by fishing and so on for them. But anyway, they went to this island, and Banfield's physique just completely changed. He became incredibly healthy, and this exponent of how really healthy it was to swim in coral waters and to live on fish and to live in this beautiful environment. And those books, I think were the equivalent in America was Thoreau writing about Walden. It's the beginning of the time when we start to look at nature and these wild places as places that can restore our soul and our physical, you know, our physiques and so on. And we're still there, aren't we? Banfield is so crucial in that story.
And yet, I mean, it's a slightly more complex story than I mean, partly he goes there in order because he's feeling a failure in other ways. And partly, you know, there's much more, there's a sort of an alternative vision of tropical paradise, which is the kind of island viceroy where he creates an avenue of trees
becomes,
to honour him.
He has rather grandiose visions of himself as a kind of, you know, receiving the governor. And yes, that's right. He did, indeed.
But was the book a literary success?
Yes, it was. It was. It's slightly overwritten. I mean, to read it now. And his wife, Bertha, who is a wonderful down-to-earth woman, you know, is kind of sustaining him in all his foibles, as always, said, you know, for God's sake, I wish he wasn't so flowery. You know, why doesn't he just write it as it is? But
and she also caused him to become resilient after the great storms of the end of the First World War that blew Dunk Island away.
I mean, Dunk Island is now blown away almost every 5 years. But 1918, they had the first, really, of what are now these successively more and more intense cyclones that are now damaging these places. And it just completely wrecked the island, and they just wanted to give up. They were in their 60s, and Banfield had another sort of almost a breakdown. But his wife, Bertha, one day found this little piece of wood that had been torn and was budding again. She said, come over here, Ted, and look at this. And he looked at it, and they decided to stay on and, you know, rebuild the island. It's very, very moving, actually.
And another aspect of it that interested me a lot was that he seems to have deepened his relationship with the indigenous people worked amongst him.
Absolutely. In fact, depended on them. That's the untold story of Banfield, because Banfield is recognised as a kind of early environmentalist, as someone who really came to understand the environment, both of the sea and the coral and the forest, but it was taught to him by the indigenous people.
Yeah, I mean, there's again something I have to read when I get the time. My favourite essay of any Australian of all time is an essay by William Stanner called Dermagum, which is a long essay about an Aboriginal man, unromanticised, deeply respectful, incredible empathy for a different world that Stanner shows. And there was a passage in the chapter on Banfield where he's writing about, remind me, of the Aboriginal man that had...
Tom. Yes, that's right.
Which reminded me...
Of
Stanner in that sense of the celebration and the seeing a world that is not ours, but utterly to be respected and having capacities we don't have and so on.
I'll just tell you one story that arises out of that. Tom showed Ted Banfield an incredible gallery of Aboriginal art that was hidden in the rocks. He calls it several galleries, and he describes them in a lot of detail. And Ted used to take people to do them, but they're lost again because the island has been smashed up by these cyclones, and there is nobody who knows where this gallery is anymore. In that, it's all just kind of overgrown. Yeah.
Anyhow, it was a wonderful chapter. If we can now, as we're trying to build the picture of the reef, we get to the period after the Second World War and the dark time. Joe Bjelke Petersen and the Queensland government. Yes. Where the reef is seen as an opportunity for oil and mining. And again, I think one of the really great figures in our history, recent history, is Judith Wright, the poet.
Absolutely.
She's played extraordinarily important role both in environmentalism and in Indigenous questions.
Yes.
A wonderful book, Cry of the Dead, which she wrote about her family and their experience as pastoralists.
In the,
haunting
in
book.
The Armidale region,
But if you, again, I didn't know this, that there's a partnership, it's mentioned in your promo, of three.
Yes.
An artist, Boost, and an ecologist, Len Fox. And
Len Webb.
Yep. And Judith Wright.
Yes. I find this so inspirational because apart from anything else, you know, I've always decried the gulf between the sciences and the arts. You know, I just think we have to work together if we're going to solve environmental problems. But here you have this extraordinary alliance between this bloke, John Buist, who is a dropout painter, sort of bohemian painter.
From a Montsalvat kind of.
Yeah, Montsalvat, ex-Montsalvat guy. And Judith Wright, the poet, and Len Webb, who is a scientist of forests, of the forests. And they became very, very close friends. And it was these three who orchestrated the fight against Joe Bjelke-Petersen and the government and of course also the oil interests. I mean, 80% of the reef had been given over to oil mining. It had been listed for oil exploration, drilling and mining. 80% of the reef. And one of his ministers, the Minister for Environment, when he was accosted by the fact that there'd been a terrible oil spill and the birds and everything were dying, he said, there's nothing wrong with oil. It's a protein. The fish can feed on it perfectly well.
A friend of humanity.
Yeah.
Like coal.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Anyway, that Save the Reef campaign did save the reef. The direct consequence of it was that the reef became a national reserve and then listed by the World Heritage Commission, you know, and that issue is now back on the table. And the whole fight that they thought they had won is having to be refought now with this Adani, this enormous Galilee coal mine. Do you know that coal mine will produce enough CO2 from that coal mine to make it the seventh greatest producer of CO2 in the world? That is, it will be bigger than most other countries, that single coal mine. And in addition to that, the coal mine is going to go in. The reef is not designed for huge flows of enormous ships.
Yeah.
It's a shallow, complicated place. And so it's going to smash up reefs. There's going to be oil spills. There's going to be dredging all the time to keep it shallow enough for all these ships. We're back. It's Judith Wright. Judith Wright finished that book saying, you know, we have won the fight, but I fear the fight might...
She had a nice phrase for it. An end without a finale.
An end, exactly.
And she was absolutely right.
That's
that
right.
The victory was temporary.
Yeah.
And it's now, I mean, as you say, it's my daughter has been involved in that campaign as part of AYCC, but Greenpeace as well.
Yes.
It's, I think, by far the most important environmental struggle now going on.
Absolutely.
In Australia, and it's one of the most important in the world.
It is, and it has mobilised people. I mean, one thing I've been very touched by is the reception of my book in the United States.
Ah, tell us a little bit about that.
Well, it's just that, you know, I assumed that it wouldn't get much mileage because they see the reef as an Australian thing.
It's not an American.
It's not American, you know.
I've just been in America.
Yeah, but in fact... it's had tremendous kind of reception. It was reviewed in all the major, you know, New York Times, New York Times Review, Wall Street, The Economist had it as the book of the year.
Tim Tannery did it in New York Review of Books.
Yes, it was really, I was really very moved. And I get letters from the United States saying, this is, you know, Australia's the custodians of the most beautiful and important organism in the world. And we are, you know, we're, as they say, rooting for you.
Which leads me to the last chapter of the book, which is about the marine biologist Charlie Veron. And you begin the chapter with a very somber moment, really, which is a lecture. Sir David Attenborough is the chair, and the lecturer is the Royal Society, which goes back to Joseph Banks and Captain Cook. You're rightly enough not to remind us, in a way, of the symmetry. But anyhow, Charlie Veron talks to them and really tells in 40 minutes that audience that the reef is under threat and that it may not survive this century.
That's right.
Say a little bit about Charlie Veron again, a lovely story about his life and
how
he's come to this position.
He's an extraordinary character, Charlie. He's a very Australian, there's a larrikin maverick element about him. Always was through his scientific career. He's called Charlie. His real name is John Veron, because his teacher, he used to bring in all these creatures to show people, worms and all sorts of things. And his teacher said, you know, ironically, one day you're Charlie Darwin. You're like Charlie Darwin, and all the kids call him Charlie, Charlie. So Charlie, it's been ever since. And in fact, he is. I call my chapter The Darwin of the Coral. He is and in fact, he won the Darwin Medal, which is the highest medal you can get for coral science or for anything in the Darwin field. But he's in many ways, what was special about Charlie is that he's a scientist whose passion was expressed initially, or even his methods were diving. He was a diver, so he observed the reef. He was not a lab scientist. He spent 7,000 hours underwater in the reef. I mean, it's nobody knows the reef more than him. And he, in fact, he's responsible for naming 20% of the world's corals. And he's lived in Townsville, where, you know, in a little bush place like that. He's a very, very kind of humble but absolutely passionate scientist, and a really great scientist. His daughter died. His daughter was drowned, and it was a very deeply traumatic experience for him. And I think my own interpretation is that in the aftermath of his daughter's death, he became more conscious of death, and he started to think about what was happening to the reef. It's dying. And so he becomes, I think, one of the great prophets of what is happening to the reef now. He's very pessimistic, I have to say. But he gives this... He's asked by the Royal Society to address best scientists of the time at this particular moment with Attenborough as the chair, and he gives this talk, and it's a very, very grim but moving moment, and beautifully rendered, because he's again one of these scientists who is determined to get the story across to people. So that's Charlie is the last person in the book, in a way, bringing us up to today, bringing us up to what threats we face now. And he's he continues to campaign.
Now, I must...
Yes.
I don't know what time we're meant to end.
It's probably now, yes, in 10 minutes,
minutes. I was aiming, and I'm sorry, I was intending 15 minutes at this point of questions from you. I'm extremely sorry that...
Oh,
no one told me that there's a clock in front here telling me how how long we have to go. So I'm very sorry. I did intend to allow some time for questions. On the other hand, it's a very rich book, and I think it's been an extraordinarily enjoyable hour that we've spent listening to Iain. So
thank you very much.